Hey everyone, it's Randal Schwartz back again with another tip, trick, or technique in the world of Dart and Flutter. Today we're going to talk about DateTime Smart Copy With. So many of you have not yet realized that as of Dart 3.0, which is what, almost a year ago now, DateTime got a little bit smarter. It got a copy with method that was really handy. Prior to that, if you wanted to create a date time that was similar to one you already had, you had to basically use the constructor and have the old value referenced multiple times in order to figure out what the new one would be. And you ended up writing a lot of things that look like this year is the same as the previous year, this month is the same as the previous month, this day is the same as the previous day. And it seemed odd that there wasn't a copy with as there is in lots of other classes. So the people in the home office decided, yeah, we'll go ahead and add a date time copy with. And to show you having that in action, let's take an arbitrary date time here. Just with a lot of different numbers so that they all stand out nicely, although that is conveniently my birthday coming up this year, near the end of the year as it always is. And I want to say the same item, but day one of that month. So instead of the 22nd, I want to change to the 1st. And this, in fact, does do that by changing only the day. Anything that's not mentioned gets copied through without change. Let me run this, and it's already the text that's down below, but we run it again to verify that. And notice here, 22 has become 1. Now, that is literally doing what copy with normally does. Anything you don't mention gets copied through. But when you're playing with dates and times, it doesn't always mean exactly what you want. I mean, look, we've got 16 milliseconds, 17 microseconds, which shows up in our output down here. That's a little silly. So what you end up doing is going, okay, I want day one of November 22nd, or November, but I also then want hour to be 0. And let's see if it does that. Minute is also 0. That's good. Second is 0. Millisecond is 0. This is my auto completion from Codium filling that out. Now that I've added all these zeros and I run this, great, I get all zeros. This is more likely what I want. When I wanted to change the day, I kind of wanted everything following that to become the default. And CopyWith doesn't do that. CopyWith treats it like every other CopyWith, which is, if you don't spell it out, I'm just going to copy it like the one before. Now, you can also do some clever tricks. Like, let's say I want the day after the 22nd, the day after my birthday. I can do things like begin, which is the previous value, day plus 1. Okay, and we run that. We see, yes, it got to 11/23rd. And again, all zeros following that, but only because I spelled these out. If I comment these back out again, okay, and then I run this, I get the incredibly useless 11/23, but again, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So I thought, you know, I'd like to have these same features where it's mostly copying what's in the original data, except when I specify a new date or I specify, a new day, everything else beyond that goes down to 0. Or even if I specified a new hour, the minutes and everything would become a 0. So I spend a little bit of time. Let's go back to the original here in day 1. I spend a little time. Let's just delete these here. Writing my own version of copy with it's just a little bit smarter. So remember, doing it this way, we update only the 1, but we get all the remaining values back. So let's change this to my smart copy with. Now, you go, okay, that's cool. That's a new thing. It's an extension, obviously, on DateTime. And we'll see the code for that in just a minute, but I wanted to show the interface first so you can kind of see what's going on. Notice I have day one here. Now, in my world, SmartCopyWith should go, oh, he's mentioned a specific day. That means he wants the beginning of that actual day. And everything else beyond that should be zeroed out. Let's see if that worked. Oh my goodness, look at this, 11:01:00. And then let's say we specify a minute of 17. Can I override just that and the rest all work correctly? Actually, I don't know. Let me run it and see what happens. Oh, I see it kept the hour as being 13, but the minute 17. But again, it zeroed out everything after the smallest unit that I introduced. Okay. And you think, well, that's kind of nice, but how do we get, is there any shortcut then for getting like the day after, given that this gives me the first of the month of November? Can I do the day being the next day? And I thought, oh, as long as I'm designing my own interface, let's allow me to put in, oh, look, it automatically expanded to what I was about to write, which is that I'm just going to give it a quick closure that's going to take the old day, here represented by D, and add one to it and shove it back in as being the updated date. Does this work? Of course it does. Look at this, 11:23, and again, because the smallest thing I specified was day, hour, minute, and second, all get zeroed out. If I want noon on that day, I can then go 12 and then hit run. Hit run, and look, now it's noon on that day. So I think this is a pretty flexible interface. For any given unit that's being copied, you can modify it by giving either an override value or, way better than CopyWith, an override function. How do we do all this in a reasonable way? Well, let's look at the source code here. Okay, let's take a look at the source code. So here I've got a bunch of comments, actual documentation, that's all fine, but let's actually drill down through the function so you can see what's going on. Let me stretch this down a little bit so you have more context. We've got SmartCopyWith, and it takes in by named parameters, year, month, day, hour, minute, second, millisecond, microsecond. It does also deal properly with things that are UTC versus local time. And I didn't have a demonstration of that, but, you know, you can play with the code once you download it yourself and play with that. Now, here's the tricky part. We actually need to evaluate optional parameters from the smallest unit to the largest unit. And the reason is that the moment we have any unit, everything after that gets replaced by a calculation of some kind, or gets copied from the original data. And if we just, and from the smallest unit on down, we set it to defaults. In fact, the documentation up here says this. If a field's not mentioned and it's smaller than any field mentioned, we use a field-specific default, typically zero, except for the day and the month, which both get ones. If a field is not mentioned, but it's not smaller than any field mentioned, it gets passed through from the original subject to any over or underflows from smaller fields. I'll demonstrate that in a few minutes. It's actually kind of fun. All right, and we have these int function int, that is our mutators. Otherwise, we just have a straight value. So now back to here, to do this processing, we're going to be stepping through the input parameters one at a time from the smallest to the largest. Microsecond is going to be the value that comes introduced. This microsecond, is because this is an extension, is the old microseconds. Same thing with millisecond and this millisecond. So milliseconds, the value passed in, if any, and this millisecond is the value that currently exists in the date time that we're copying from. Okay, all the way down. Notice most of these don't have a default, and we'll see that it defaults to zero up in the function itself. But we also have some for day, month, and year. Notice day, if not specified, defaults to 1. Month, if not specified, defaults to 1. And year, if not specified, retains the previous year. So in other words, if I do a date time and smart copy with and don't say anything, it automatically gets the same year and January 1st of that year. So how do these sequence of things actually start getting calculated? We're passing them one at a time into this fix function. We start out with a scene variable, which is a bool, and we set it at false. This means we have not yet seen any of these parameters, and this is going to work into our calculations to decide what we do. Now, we're going to get the new value, we're going to get the previous value. New value is coming from the parameters to this extension. Previous value is going to come from the existing date time values, and then we have the default value, which defaults to the default is 0. Otherwise, it's the 1 and 1 in previous year like we had before. Okay, then I have a helper function, and the reason for that is there are a couple of things I'm about to calculate that I want to say, give me the value, and by the way, as a side effect, set scene to true. So we put as seen around that, and thanks to Simon Lightfoot for that particular side effect trick on that one. So that's kind of nice. Actually, thanks to Simon Lightfoot for most of this code. I really appreciate the work that we did together pair programming to create this. Okay, now let's get to where the goodies actually are. We're going to, in fix now, this is all still within the fix function, we're going to switch on the value that was given as the parameter to the extension. That's new value. And we're doing a switch here based on what it might be. So if it's null, and we've already seen some value, that means we didn't give, for example, minutes, but we did specify something like seconds that was smaller. That means we're going to retain the minutes from the previous value. Okay, so that's one case. When we've seen something already and this current one is null, that means not specified, we're going to get the previous value. Now we also have final int n as seen. So if we see a number, if we actually have a number on the operation, then we use that number. If we say the number 17, it gets to be 17. But as a side effect, we're invoking this function that sets seen to be true, saying, oh, yeah, we've already seen something now. So everything after this goes to that other phase of bigger than something we've already seen. If it's null, but we haven't seen anything yet, it just gets to be the default value. And that doesn't trigger seen now. That does not trigger seen because this is like at the level of microseconds and milliseconds and seconds like we had in the previous examples. We're just going to be popping mostly into this, which means we're going to just copy the previous values. Oh, the default value gets copied in. So that's going to be zeros and stuff. So. Then comes the interesting part. If we recognize that parameter is a function that takes an int and returns something, then we run that function on the previous value. So this is feeding the previous value as the input to that function and resulting in a new int that we're going to plug in to that particular slot. So that's a lot of fun. We have to have some casting in here because we need this to be dynamic, to be recognized for the kind of little functions that we had. Just a bit of dancing because of all the strong typing. You can go through it in detail if you want, not really relevant to this discussion. Finally, we make it all the way down past all of our choices and none of those match. Probably an error. So we'll take the value, whatever it is, final V will match everything. It's like using an underscore, except it gives me a value, V, that I can then use in an error message, in this case, throwing the argument error. Okay, so now what we've seen so far is we're going to call fix a number of times, one for each of the categories of the sizes. We're going to get new updated values returned back as a list. That's what this list is from here down to here, Now, we've done it from microsecond to year order, smallest to biggest. But we ultimately want to plop it into a new constructor from biggest to smallest. So there we get a reversed. The reversed gets inserted into a list, which is this list here. And this becomes the argument list that apply is using. Apply takes a function and passes it a list of positional parameters. This is the list of positional parameters, and it will be in the proper order from biggest to smallest, because that's the order for that. Now, we only have one other tricky part, and that is if we've requested UTC rather than local time, the constructor will be the UTC tear-off. So that's going to be the constructor from the DateTime class that has the UTC name. Otherwise, we use the constructor from the DateTime class that has no name, and that's signified in tear-offs by doing .new, just like we've got here. Okay, so there's the constructor being called. It's either the UTC or new, depending on the values. This is UTC. So that's the previous UTC setting. We copy that over if it's appropriate. Otherwise, if you specify either a true or false with is UTC on the parameter list, that's going to pick a specific one or the other of those. And again, function apply is going to return dynamic by default. So we do an as DateTime at the end. And we're through. There we go. We're all done. That's how the code that's in there. I'm going to put this code up in a gist. Eventually, I may package it as an actual pub module, but I'm still kind of work in progress with it a little bit, and I want a chance to kind of sort that out. So I'm going to put this into a gist shortly, and I'll put this in the show notes, the link to the gist, and you can fetch it down from there. Hope you enjoyed this, and I think I'm going to be finding lots of applications for my Smart Copy With for a DateTime. Okay, thank you much. If you enjoyed this presentation, please feel free to contribute to my Patreon or just buy me a coffee. The links are in the show notes.